After talking about our basic block, which is an adder, we can now move on to a more complex block, which is the multiplier. And let's start with basic multiplication. And actually, I'm going to start even earlier than that. Go back to grade school and remember about multiplication. How did we do it? When's the last time you took a pen and paper and did this? And the reason I'm doing it is just so we'll remember the mechanics a bit. So what we're going to do is we're going to start with our lowest numeral here, which is a 2. We're going to take this 2 and we're going to multiply it by the entire multiplicand that comes into here. So we do 2 times 4 equals 8, 2 times 3 equals 6, 2 times 2 equals 4, and 2 times 1 equals 2. And we get one of our partial product vectors over here, one of our numbers. Then we move over to the next numeral, and this one is the tens place. If this was the ones place, this is the tens place. So what we're going to do is we're going to basically shift our partial product that we're going to get by 10. We're going to multiply it by 10. And then we do 1 times 4, 1 times 3, 1 times 2, 1 times 1. And since it's a 1, we just can copy this. So we get 1, 2, 3, 4. And we're going to add these two together because there were only two numerals in the multiplier. And we get 8, 10. We'll carry the 1. We'll get 8 over here. We'll get 4 and we'll get 1. And that brought us to our product, to our final result. So multiplication using serial addition is basically the same exact thing. Here we take another number that's in binary, 101010 times 1011. And what we're going to do now is look at this, and we have, again, the multiplicand, that's the top one, and the multiplier, that's the bottom one. The name multiplier really drives me nuts because every time I say multiplier, am I relating to this vector over here, or am I relating to the entire block? But these are the names that they are officially given. So in this case, what we're going to do actually is going to take our lowest bit, and we're going to AND it with each one of these bits. Okay, so 1 and 0, 1 and 1, 1 and 0, 1 and 1, 1 and 0, 1 and 1, and put each one of them in the corresponding place underneath. It's actually much easier than that, because when we take an AND gate, the 1 just copies the actual vector that's over here. So 1 times 101010 is just 101010. Now we're going to move over to our next bit, and that's actually in the 2 to the power of 1 place. So again, we're shifting left over here, which again is multiplying the whole thing by 2. Again, here we have a 1, and the 1 is going to multiply this whole thing. With an AND, it's just copying the entire content. So again, we're going to have a 101010 over here with an empty space over here, which corresponds to another 0. We're going to shift again now, okay? And this time we have a 0 in our multiplier. So the 0, just a 0, and this whole thing just zeros out everything. So we get a line of zeros. And our final shift is going to again copy the content, and we're going to have a line of that's the same as the multiplicand. Okay, so now we have our partial product array, and we are going to sum them up. So we take 0, and then 1 plus 0, 0 plus 1 plus 0, and so forth, and we get our final sum over here, which is our result. So it's exactly the same as our grade school decimal multiplication. It's just done in binary in this way. So to sum that up, our binary multiplication has the multiplicand and the multiplier, which often will show it just as a dot, which can be either a 0 or a 1 because it represents a binary number. What we get here are the partial products that come out. Each one corresponds to a different bit in the multiplier over here. Okay, and again, it's going to be just a copy of the multiplicand if the bit was a 1, or a line of zeros if the bit was a 0. And we call this entire thing the partial product array. Okay, sometimes it's called a parallelogram because, as you can see, it is a parallelogram. Okay, and then we're going to sum these up, and we're going to get the product. And the product is double precision. So if we had an n-bit multiplicand and an n-bit multiplier, then our product can be up to 2n bits. And that's an important part as well. We also have exactly n of these partial products because our multiplier had n bits in it. Okay. And another thing that we just have to pay attention to is that each one of these is just an AND between one of these and one of these. This one is an AND between this and this. So we can do all these things in parallel and provide them at the same time. Okay, so how are we going to go about implementing a hardware adder? And we'll go back to the serial type of process, which uses the least amount of hardware, but it's easiest to do. And we can see the schematic over here on the right. The concept is, again, that multiplying by a 1 is just copying the multiplicand, while multiplying by 0 provides a row of zeros. And so we have this multiplexer over here that on the one hand, it gets the multiplicand that goes into it. So if the multiplier bit is going to be a 1, we're going to select the multiplicand. If the multiplier bit is a 0, we're just going to select a row of zeros. That is going to go into an adder, which is going to be added to our partial product, which we've been storing all. It starts at 0, but we store it over here. We take the addition and we add it to the result. So this is going to be driven back into the partial product, stored over here, and then we're going to shift. So we're going to take the next bit of the multiplier, do the same thing, make the addition, and add it to basically what we had here plus times 2. And we're going to continue that for n cycles. Okay, so we are going to do this. But again, if the k-bit adder takes o to the k or something like that, or o to the n for ripple carry adder type of thing, and we needed n cycles to provide this multiplication, it's an n by n multiplier, then this is going to be pretty heavy. We're going to have o n squared process in order to get one result, and that's really a lot. So instead, we should go and look if we can do it, use our hardware, instead of doing serially, do it in a parallel fashion, or in other words, to calculate the final product in a single combinatorial calculation, and potentially this could be done in one cycle. So what we said before is that each one of these partial product bits is just an AND gate. So this one is an AND gate between the first bit of the multiplier and the first bit of the multiplicand. This one will be the first bit of the multiplier times the second bit of the multiplicand, etc. And these again are just these AND gates that can be produced in parallel for each and every single one of these partial product bits that we have here. So in other words, we have them at the beginning, and it's just the delay of one single AND gate, and we have n by n or something of these AND gates in order to produce these partial product bits. That's really nice. So we can really just go over there and provide all these AND bits and now sum up all of the partial products to get the final result. So how are we going to actually implement this? Okay, we don't have such a thing as an n vector adder, but we only showed in our previous parts of this lesson that we have a 2-input adder. So what we're going to actually do is really stack up 2-input adders. So as you can see here, we can take the first 2 partial product vectors, put them inside an adder, provide the sum, take the sum, put it inside another adder with the next partial product bit, provide the sum, put it in adder with the next partial product bit, and finally we'll get the final output. So that's the kind of process we're going to do, and that brings us to the array multiplier. So we can see here a schematic of a small one of these. So we have our AND gates that produce our partial products for our first two partial product vectors. We stick them into a ripple carry adder over here. We take the result, put it into another ripple carry adder with the partial products from the next bit of the multiplicand, and take the result of that, stick it into a final adder with the final bits of the last partial product vector. So that is something that we can do, but what is the complexity of this thing? So let's look for the critical path over here. So it looks like the critical path would be something like this, and we can see that it has to go through full adders that are the number of partial product vectors we have, which in the case of an n by n array would be something like n, but then it has to go and ripple through the whole ripple carry adder or whatever type of addition we have here, so we have another n of these, so we get 2n pretty much is our complexity. But looking through this, there's a problem over here that we actually have more and more of these types of critical paths that are exactly the same size. So you have many, many, many critical paths going through these things that are all the same. And when they're many critical paths, it's really hard to work on one critical path trying to optimize it. Okay, so if we look at the complexity of this thing, we can make all kinds of calculations and estimations and so forth. But the basic deal is that we have something like O of 2n, if we have an n by n multiplier, or n plus m, if one of the vectors is the size size n and the other is size m. In other words, the height times the width of the height is n and the width is m, or the opposite. Usually we're going to be discussing, you know, equal sized vectors, so it'll be like 2n, so n equals m. Okay, so that's a big problem because it's a large delay. 2n is large, and we can't go and just optimize one thing away because there are so many critical paths. So that brings us to the question, is if we can do it better. And here we have a dot diagram of the multiplier, and this kind of shows us how this multiplier works, right? And so we have all our partial products shown here as dots that we then have to sum up. We have to, you know, take this, we can immediately provide the output. These two we have to sum up, then these three we have to sum up. And one of the things over here that we can figure out is actually what we're doing here is the sum of each bit is just counting the number of ones we have in one of the columns that are above it. And the question is, do we have to go and, you know, take these two guys and ripple the carry all the way through this before we can then calculate the sum of this? Or is there a way to somehow do this more in parallel? And the answer is yes. We can just actually, we don't really need to ripple the carry through because the carry is just a one that is one column to the left of the column that produced it. So if these two guys are added together in the initial adder and they provide a carry, we don't necessarily have to add that carry over here to the adder that figures out these guys. We can add it anywhere along this column over here. So we can just drive it actually into the next to the next row over here, and then we don't have to ripple the carry. We can just assume that all the carry ins are zeros over here and use the carries on our next stage adder. And let's see what that does. So that brings us to what we call a carry save adder. So as you can see here, all of the inputs over here are zeros to these full adders. Okay, and what we do is we take the two inputs, the two partial product bits, we add them together, and the carry we drive down to the next row. Okay, and that we're going to do for each of these rows. We're going to drive the carry to the next row until we can't go any further, basically. So we get a much shorter path of the carry that goes down. And if we look at this, each one of these will have this type of a path of a carry that's much, much shorter. It's actually n minus 1 t carries. And the nice thing about it is in the end, we get, you know, two bits that we need to add together. Basically two vectors, and two vectors is just the input to an adder, and we can implement this adder any way this adder down here any way we want. We don't have to use a ripple carry adder. We can take these two bits and stick them into a carry look ahead adder, for example, and get a log 2 of the complexity. So we can really reduce, instead of 2n, we can get to something like n log n, n plus log n complexity in a carry save adder, and that's really nice. Furthermore, if we look at how we implement this type of a thing in a layout type of a way, so here's the floor plan of our carry save multiplier. So we have the half adder here that drives the carry down to the next line. The half adder here drives it down to the next line, etc. And the carry here is driven down the next line, and so forth. Well, and then again, the last row of these, instead of being a ripple carry adder, we're going to make it with any type of adder we want. We can use a carry look ahead adder or one of the other adders that we learned before. Now, looking at this interesting type of structure, we can go and we can make a really nice implementation that's square, that's not a parallelogram, but it's rather a square type of a thing. So we take the x's and the y's, and which are the bit inputs to the array, and we route them straight through, broadcast them through the array over here. And with this type of a setup, we can get a really nice tight layout of our entire multiplier, and that's a real nice type of a thing to do. So a carry save adder also gives us a really nice implementation with short wires, with straight wires, without very much routing complexity, and therefore it's a very popular implementation of such a multiplier. However, it still is pretty slow, and so in the next part of our lecture, we'll go over and look at how to expedite the calculation of multiplication and do it better.